Broad Street. I'm Joe Green, the senior pastor here. Just so glad you're here. I brought a few of my friends. And we certainly welcome you. And we certainly welcome the orchestra back, don't we? Amen. You're in for it. Yeah. You're in for a special treat, as you know. Because we gather today to worship God. And when we come in one accord, God's going to do some awesome things among us. If you pull out your announcement sheet, I just want to say a word or two. And be sure and sign to register at the end of the pew and pass those across. I want to mention the Creative Souls. This is always an awesome event here at the church. And this is coming up on Wednesday, the 21st. That's this week. And you'll see there on the front of your announcement. Be sure and read that and check that out. Want to mention, too, that we've got over 20 going on this mission trip this week to Oklahoma to build a church there on the reservation. So I ask that you would keep those guys in prayer. That's an exciting ministry of the church, and it's just an exciting thing to see our church ministering that far away. And of course, Danny Howell's leading them, and so keep him in your prayers. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
As printed in our order of worship. Blessed be the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Praise
Our help is in God's name, the one who calls us here.
We come with songs of praise, with prayers too deep for words.
Blessed be the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Blessed be.
Make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the heights of the mountains are also his. The sea is his, for he made it, and the dry land which his hands have formed. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the sheep of his hand. O come, let us sing to the Lord. join me this morning in saying our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I'd like all of our third graders to come forward today. Today we will be giving our Bibles to third graders. This is one of my favorite days. You guys will just come up and stand right here. We have several boys in here getting their Bibles today. Thank you, boys. It's the tradition of First Broad Street to present our third graders with a Bible of their own. We are recognizing that they are maturing, that their reading skills and comprehension are getting better, and that they're able to really take in these stories that God has given us in the Bible. I can tell you that this is a very fine group of third graders. Oh, wonderful, there's Cameron, good. I was missing you, buddy. Come on up here. There are 13 third graders who will be receiving Bibles today. It's a great group. They are kind and compassionate, intelligent. They're leaders. You'll see them leading as they grow. But most of all, they're followers of Christ. And I know that many of us probably remember the day that some of these kids were baptized right up here when you were babies. Do y'all remember that? No, you don't. And we made a promise to you that day to do all that we could to encourage you in your faith as you grow. And this is one way for us to be able to do that. We are excited today to give you these Bibles. I want you to know that all of these Bibles have been tabbed especially for you. There are verses that have been highlighted. You'll notice when you get your Bibles, there are little colored tabs on the pages. Some of those are my favorite verses. Some of those are your parents' favorite verses that they have given to me to tab in your Bibles. But what we want to see you all take these Bibles and make them your own. You're old enough to go to that Bible when you're feeling sad, or when you're lonely, when you're feeling a little lost, or when you're happy and you have something to celebrate. That's what they're for. And I want you to make these Bibles your own, okay? Don't be afraid to tab them. Don't be afraid to highlight or underline a verse that's special to you. You know what? Because it makes it easier when you go back. You can find those really quickly, your favorite ones. Makes it kind of easier. But when I call your name, I want you to come get the Bible. And we also have a parent guide that will go with it this year that will help your parents celebrate this special gift with you. And remember to take it with you when you come to Sunday school now. You're a big kid, and you'll have your Bible with you, right? Yeah. Okay. All right. So first we have Benjamin David Culp. So Benjamin, and you can just stand right there until everybody gets theirs. Next we have Christopher Egan. Brandon Jacob Foster. And Cameron James Roberts. Would you join with me in saying a prayer for these guys? Dear Lord, we thank you for the precious gift that you have given us in your word, and also for the precious gift that you have given us in these children. Lord, they are an encouragement to people that they come into contact with, and they are a blessing to this church. We thank you for that. We thank you for the gift that you have given us to be able to give back to these kids by giving them your word. Lord, we pray that your word will rest in their hearts and become apparent in their lives. We ask that you would help them to become familiar with your word, that you would help them to be comfortable with it and to make these Bibles their own. And we ask all this in your name. Amen. And we will dismiss for godly play.
You know, that's exciting, isn't it? To know that that a new generation is rising up who will be leaders in this world and will be making an incredible difference through the witness of this church. They will be making an incredible difference for our Lord. So we want to keep our children, our young people, certainly in our prayers day by day. Let us join our hearts together now as we would pray. Father, as we gather here today and we celebrate these children that have been given your word, your truth to guide them, that their lives would be different from perhaps those around them, give them power through your Holy Spirit to be the kind of people that you created them to be. Lord, we're thankful today to come into this place so lifted up in praise to you, Father, to come into your presence through the avenue of worship. Father, it is an awesome thing to sense you so close. And we realize, Lord, that so often in our own lives, we have sought different kinds of things and people to bring us happiness and fulfillment, satisfaction in life. But gathering like this, we understand again that it's all about you. That our experience that puts us on the very cutting edge of life is our experience with you. Gathering here, some have done this for years, Lord. Gathering in this sanctuary on a regular basis to let you know how they feel, to lift you high and to glorify you. Father, we're thankful for the privilege we have to worship and to worship you together. Father, for the avenues that you open that we might touch this old world, that we might offer that cup of cold water to someone, perhaps folks there in Oklahoma, folks in South Sudan, folks across the street, folks in our family. Father, that you've given us the sacred call to be your people wherever we are. And may our lives be a life that is one of worship and praise to you. Lord, this morning as we pray, we lift up these who are in the hospitals. We think of Alex Anderson, Beverly Jones, Scott McDonald, Mamie Pechtel, Doris Ross. And we pray for their healing and their wholeness, Lord. And we offer our Christian sympathy, Lord, to Laura Bussey on the death of her husband, Ronald. Denise McCright and the family on the death of her grandfather. And Rick Shaver and his family on the death of his mother. Minister to them in the way that only you can. Deep within, let them know that you are close. And as we pray, we'll not forget to pray the prayer that your Son, our Savior, taught us to pray when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
You know, in a few moments, Reverend Green, Joe, is going to tell us about how we're wired for worship. But we're also wired to be a blessing. Just like Abraham of old was blessed to be a blessing, we too get to share in that experience. And really, that's where we receive our most fulfillment and satisfaction, when we're aligned with God, and as these orchestra members can attest, can be the instruments of God in order to be able to share the blessings he's given us to those around us. So let us now collectively become a blessing to others by sharing our gifts, offerings, and tithes.
Oh!
So praise, worship, and honor you today. Please accept these gifts, multiply them, help them to enable us to grow and to be able to reach out to serve others in your grace, love, and mercy. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please join me in preparing our hearts for the scripture and sermon by saying together the prayer of illumination in your bulletin. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice of your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The scripture lesson today is from the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1. So then, my friends, because of God's great mercy to us, I appeal to you, offer yourselves as a living sacrifice to God, dedicated to his service and pleasing to him. This is the true worship you should offer. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
It's an awesome thing to be in the midst of a voice of praise, isn't it? And the Lord said that he would dwell in the midst of the praises of his people. And I've just been lifted up just being in this service and hearing you sing and the orchestra. And we certainly appreciate Gay Acock and Bob Garver for their work and They've done an awesome thing. Thank you so much. You know, we are a blessed people. You know that. That as I've said over the last few weeks, that we are wired. You know, it's like Beth was having a copier installed in the house, and we're having some problems there. And I don't know that usually she just puts it all together and it works. I just trust her. I'm married, and you know it's the way it is. But anyway, the person that was helping said that you can hook this thing up to your phone. It's amazing what your phone can do, isn't it? That if you've got a smartphone and you're not too smart, then you can't really figure out everything it can do. I mean, it's amazing what you can do with a phone, and the potential of it. And the way it is wired. And that's also true of us, that we are a wired people. And I mean, we're wired in a different way than the group was last Saturday night in Bristol. I understand that they drank 546,000 bottles of beer at $8 a shot. I hope they will send a tithe our way. But you talk about a wired group, and the ones that showed up in church on Sunday last week, they were kind of like this in worship. And you know, there was But we are a wired people, none wired like the people of God. And as we have gone through that the last few weeks, we found that we are a people that we're wired to believe. We're wired weird, some of us more than others perhaps. But the Bible says we are a peculiar people because we are a holy people. And we're also wired, as we found out last week, that we are wired. We're wired to overcome. As we looked at Jeremiah's experience on 9/11, on his own 9/11, and how we have those experiences all through life. Today, like none other people upon the face of the earth, we are wired to worship. And you know how sometimes at Christmas we feel like we bless our children too much, or whatever, we give them too much, or whatever, should we have done this or that. With God, you can't overdo the worship. That He is worthy. You can say, well, I hope we didn't get the big head. You know, there's none like God. That when the curtain was pulled back at creation there in Genesis 1, when the eternal curtain was pulled back, there was but one on stage, God. He is synonymous with the beginning. You know, without Him, there is no beginning. You know, that God is the one who is worthy, that could fling out several billion, perhaps 350 billion galaxies, it's thought by some, as we would fling the water drops off our fingertips. That He is worthy, and yet you think of a God that great and that awesome, and He loves you and me. He knows about our tomorrow, and He's concerned. Isn't it something that all the heavens that have been created, all the galaxies that have been created, it was really all about the people who would occupy Earth. That it's really, God gave us His attention, that all of creation is created for us. And I was thinking about this last night, just kind of going over my notes, but in Isaiah 45:18, he writes, "For the Lord is God, and He created the heavens and earth, and put everything in place. He made the world to be lived and not to be a place of empty chaos. He made you and me so He could love us." You know, that there is none quite like us. When scientists talk about the Big Bang, you open the book of Genesis and it talks about the big conversation. Where science might be seeking the how of creation, when you open the book of Genesis, it's the who. You know, that He said, "Let there be," and there was, and there is. And we praise Him, and we worship Him with stringed instruments. Even Thomas here, he's let loose now, this thing. And it's an awesome thing to see the generations up here to praise Him and to worship Him. Isn't that an awesome thing? Glad you're here today. I mean, really, really, it's an awesome place to be. Now, my notes are in your bulletin. If you're a visitor today, you'll find my notes there. And I want to just move through a few things. That when you think about worship, what do you think about? You think about songs, you think about the orchestra, you think about doing church. Beth and I, wherever we go to different churches and just see how people do things. And to jump in the middle of it, and we find that there's always that common strand there, because we are worshipers, we are Christians, we are God's people, and we worship together. But look at that quote I have for you there by Francis Chan. Francis wrote Crazy Love, and if you've never read that book, that's one you might want to pick up. It's dangerous, but it's a great book. "Have you ever wondered if we're missing it?" he says. It's crazy if you think about it. The God of the universe, the creator of nitrogen and pine needles, galaxies and E minor, loves us with a radical, unconditional, self-sacrificing love. And what is our typical response? We go to church, sing songs, and try not to cuss. Isn't that amazing? That the one who loves us unconditionally, he says, self-sacrificing love, And the best we can do is sing a few songs and try not to cuss. One guy said, Louis Giglio said, he talks about the church of the 21st century. He says, a sleeping church mired in the comfort of middle ground. But see, you come into atmosphere of this, and you realize this is not middle ground. This is where he is. This is the worship. And worship creates an atmosphere, wherever you are, it creates an atmosphere where God can do mighty things in our midst. You know, it is the atmosphere, as real as rain or snow or whatever. This is the atmosphere where things can really happen. Look again at Francois Fénelon. He says, to just read the Bible, attend church, and avoid big sins is this passionate, wholehearted love for God. Really. Max Dupree says, again, look at your notes. It is important to remember that we cannot become what we need to be by remaining what we are. That we are a people in constant changing. And if you're not in the midst of change in your life, you know, then you're not really living. That's proof of life, that we're changing. And our worship of God ought to be more awesome than it ever was before. My parents, I grew up, you heard me talk about my mother being a church organist for 80 years. That's a long song, isn't it? But our house was always full of worship. That when you walked in, it's full of worship. And God was always close, and it created the feelings of like we'd walk in the back door, and Dad would come through that back door every day, and I might walk in behind him, and he grabs my mother, and they're boogieing a little bit, you know, a lot of hugging and loving going on, you know, that it flowed out of worship of God, because he set us free to be who he created us to be, and that's an awesome thing, and I'll always have a song in my heart because of that. Now look at your notes. That worship is my response to God's love. That we respond really because God has made the first move toward us. You know what? When I was in school, I'd reached that age where I realized that I really wasn't very cool. You know. And so you start combing your hair differently and trying to be cool because you realize that there are babes out there. And then when you find one and you pick her out, you know, you're at the ripe old age of, you know, 11 or 12. And you see that girl and your heart just begins there. Wow, man, look at that. And yet you do not commit yourself because you don't want to look bad. It would be uncool to go up and make your move and she rejects you. Right? Guys? Hello? Isn't that right? You know that's right. Isn't that right? Remember that, Thomas. But you know what I'm saying? That you've got to find out. So what you do is you send spies in. You send your friends in. And they go among the friends of that girl. And you say, see that guy? He thinks you're cool, and you're there trying to look cool, you know. And then they come back with the word that it's okay, Joe. It's okay. Something is happening. There is chemistry here. And then you can walk up with confidence, you know. Just kind of walk up and say, hey, man, what's happening? And suddenly life takes on new dimension, right? Because you are accepted and you are loved, and so you know that you are cool. Hey, God has made the first move. He's made the first move. Isn't that something? That he's come forth and said, I love you. It's okay. I'm not going to reject you. You're not going to come to me and unreservedly just give so freely and worship of me, lifting your heart, your hands, your lives before me. You're not going to do that and say, oh, I don't want to hear this. But he receives us. He receives us and he loves us. You there? Hello? This is better than a ball game. And worship also, look again at your notes, is giving back to God. Wow, don't you love it when your kids are grateful? I remember when I graduated from King College and I was number 6 of 7 children. My parents had sacrificed that all of us to go to college. And you know, it's quite an ordeal and all of that. And they put up with a lot of A lot of crazy stuff for me, you can imagine. But at graduation, it just kind of hit me. You know, you're there in that robe thinking, man, if I get this thing off, I'll never put another one on. And here I am, you know. But anyway, you got this robe and you got the mortarboard on and you're trying to be cool and all of that. But you see your mom and dad and all that they have given and the support and the encouragement. And they were always there. And I just went up and hugged them and thanked them. And tears in their eyes and lots of tears in my eyes and overflowing and all of that. But we need to respond. We need to give back and be thankful. Look at the scripture. Look at this. In Mark 12, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. That God wants me to love him, and it says there in those verses, he wants me to love him thoughtfully with my mind. He wants me to love him passionately with my heart and soul. He wants to love him practically with all my strength. And what does that mean? Now look at this. This is our message right here. First of all, worship is focusing my attention on God. And you know, God is so focused on us. And if you look at the scripture there in Psalm 139, you have looked deep into my heart, Lord, and you know all about me. Isn't that something? Who knows all about you? Does anybody? You know, my wife knows a lot about me. She could talk about me for days. You know, that bless her heart. But anyway, she knows a lot about me, but not like God. Not like God. You've looked deep into my heart and you know all about me. You know when I am resting or when I am working. You've noticed everything I do and everywhere I go. He says, you know, you're there. Attention is so important. And you see it there. Focusing our attention on God. If you don't show somebody attention, it's hard to say you love them. You know, I was walking yesterday through a neighborhood and I came upon my neighbor. I was telling this in the second service. Russell Taylor was out in his yard and he was with his boys, you know, and he was giving them attention and they were eating it up. And I see that among our people here in the church, the attention that they get. You know, there's nothing like attention. When Katie was giving the Bibles to those boys, you know, and they had gone through and you saw they had the markers in there because there were verses they wanted those young people to know. That Katie and Brandy have really put a lot of effort in the ministry to our children, showing them attention. And there's nothing that we can get greater than attention. How can we say we love a God that we give no attention to? Again, look at the scripture, Romans 8. Focusing on yourself, and this is, you know, we're self-centered by nature, even from children up. We're always crying out for attention. Focusing on yourself is the opposite of focusing on God. Anyone completely absorbed in self ignores God and ends up thinking more about self than God. And that's so true. So what do we do? Look again at Scripture, Romans 12. Listen to this. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture, that is, getting so involved in the culture and doing things just to fit in or to be politically correct or whatever. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. So you say, how do we do that? How do we do that? Look again at your scripture. First of all, the first thing is to establish a daily time with him. I can prepare a sermon, and we got quite a few ministers in a congregation here. And they'll tell you, you can prepare a sermon without preparing yourself. That you go through the regimen of putting together your sermon when you need to really spend time before God and say, speak to me, God. You know, the one who would share needs to be in shape. And you can put together a sermon, but you need to spend time with him just about yourself. And Sunday school teachers, and we can go on and on about that, but establish a daily time. Look at this. This is Matthew 6. You've heard me read this before. This is the message. And Jesus here talking. He said, here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. You see that? Just be there. Just be there simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense His grace. So the first thing you got to do in this thing of attention is to find some time with Him. And then secondly, develop a constant conversation with God. Look at the scripture. Worship Him continually. Worship changes your perspective on life, because suddenly the things you worry about, the things you fear, the things you struggle with, those things you deal with daily that are overwhelming you, if they're overwhelming you, you're focusing on the wrong thing. You're focused on that, on those problems, on those situations, on those impossibilities, instead of focusing on God who knows no impossibilities. So you see, the focus is so important. And it changes your whole perspective when it's a continual thing. Worship Him continually. It doesn't say anything about Sunday morning or anything. Worship Him continually, and what will happen? Look at this. Isaiah 26, and this is Beth's mother. This was her favorite verse, Isaiah 26:3. You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, whose thoughts are fixed on you. Hope, confidence, love, joy flows out of that. If you don't want that, don't bother with it. You know, but if you do, if you want your life to be different, whoever you are, if you want life to be different, if you want to have a spring in your step, if you want to know that God is there with you, no matter what the situations you face, they're not bigger than Him. That if you want that, you'll do those things. Spend time with Him and worship Him continually. Focus. Give Him attention. Secondly, worship is expressing my affection to God. In many religions, God is like He's like a tyrant. And so the people who follow that God will try to appease Him because He's angry, but not our God. Not our God. Listen to this. We love Him because He first loved us. What did I say a while ago? I mean, you can approach somebody so much easier if you know they love you. You know, if you're not sure, or you're not sure what kind of mood you're in or whatever, you're real halting as you would approach them, if you would approach them at all. But with God, we love Him because He first loved us. And He says this in Hosea 6, I don't want your sacrifices. God says, I want your love. I don't want your offerings. I want you to know me. Don't treat God like a blind date. You may here ever go on a blind date. Now, if you made that blind date, don't lift your hand, please, because I'm going to hit you with something. When I went to King College, I had this friend, and I took him home one time, you know, just to kind of hang out over in the hills with me. So I was dating a girl there, swept her off her feet, but I was dating this girl, just kidding. And I said, I'm bringing my buddy home, get him a date. Don't ever do that. You know, to this day, after all these years, that guy's still sore about that, I think. You know that? Really, he said, I can't believe you did that to me. And you know, he took me home with him and got me a date with a beauty queen. And then I take him home, but we treat God like that, you know? We're not taping this service, are we? Oh, my. He says, now look at this. Exodus 30. He is a God who is passionate about His relationship with you. Wow. Isn't that something? That it's safe. It's safe to give Him all that we are and all that we have. And that's what it says in Romans 6. Give yourselves completely to God since you've been given new life. It's safe to love Him back. And then finally, worship is using my abilities for God. Look at Colossians 3. Paul wrote this at the church at Colossae. This is awesome. Because if you plug into this verse, it'll revolutionize your life. Revolutionize your life. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as though you were working for the Lord and not for people. Isn't that something? As though you were working for the Lord. Would that matter to you? Would you do anything any differently if you were working for Him? How you lived with... You know how sometimes you dread going to work? What would your boss say tomorrow if he got a new employee and it was you? That guy you worked for him for 10 years... He's made your life miserable. But you decided, I'm not working for Him anymore. I'm working for God because he loves me. He thinks I'm something else. He thinks I'm awesome. I'm working for him. It'll put a song in your heart. Try that. Try that. That boss that's driving you nuts, that job that you can't wait till you retire and you're only 28. Huh? But what if you work as according to the Lord? He says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as though you were working for the Lord and not for people. And then he says this in Romans 12. This is the message. I love it. Take your everyday, ordinary life. You're sleeping, eating, going to work, walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Wow. Place it before God as an offering. Would it be any different tomorrow? Now look at the last verse. So we make it our goal to please him. Turning the mundane into worship. Now, you with me? Straighten up. Straighten up. Time, we're okay. You can still be the Baptist. Straighten up. Okay, take a deep breath. Smile. And turn to the person next to you and say, I'm miserable. You see, psychologists call this act as if. Act as if. In other words, that maybe you've fallen out of love with your spouse. At least you feel that. But what if you began to act as if you still love that person? You begin to act as if. Christians call this faith. Your posture, your radiance, even the way you say things, it's different. And as you act as if, psychologists say, things begin to happen. And even much greater than that, we Christians know what will happen as we do it in faith. You with me? Why? Because we worship a God who knows no impossibilities. We know what love's all about because we are loved. We are loved. We are known by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Let's pray together. Father, Lord, the potential, just the potential that each one of us have. We are wired to worship you, but if we took that worship to another level, not just confined to a room or a sanctuary, but in and through our lives, in our work. If instead of working for the boss or even for ourselves, we work for you and know that when we work for you, your blessing will be upon it. It will not only get a job done, it will transform people around us. And those people in our lives that drag us down and beat us to death, forgive us for focusing on them and the negative. Lord, may our focus be upon you again, who knows no impossibility. How great and awesome you are, worthy of our worship that we give ourselves without reservation, knowing we are accepted and we are loved as we give ourselves completely to you in the name above every name, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let's stand together and take the faith we sing as we sing Great is the Lord, number 2022.
By his mercy, he grows his name.
As we continue now, please remain standing. We want to receive a new member into the church, and if you'll look on your bulletin, I'll ask John Cain and Carolyn to come up. John is going to join our church today, and we're excited to have him join. And if you will look at the bottom of the page on the back of your bulletin, I want to ask you just a few questions, my friend. We're excited to have you join. First of all, do you renew the solemn vow and promise made at your baptism? You believe the scriptures are contained in the Old and New Testaments of the Scripture, the Bible? Will you do your very best to live a Christian life as God grants you His grace? And will you serve the United Methodist Church with your prayers, your presence, your gift, your service, and your witness? Amen. Amen. Look on your bulletin, and as we receive Him, let us say this together. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. That in everything, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Isn't this great? John, we welcome you, and you get your very own badge that most of you forget to wear each week. But John won't. I know you won't. Carolyn, thank you. Let's pray for him. Father, we thank you for John and Carolyn. Lord, that as I place my hand on him, Lord, I pray that your hand would continue to be upon him. I know you've got a special place for him in your church here. And Lord, I thank you for the ways that you are leading people, the avenues, the doors that are opening for people to come and be a part of First Broad Street. But Lord, we serve you, and we serve you together with worship in our hearts. Now, as we depart, you go forth with us. Go forth with us, Lord, and as we seek to make a difference for you, live your life through us, and may our lives be one of praise to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's let John and Carolyn leave first. We're going to put them in the back so folks, some of y'all can meet him and her. And go ahead with a postlude and I'll... I'm so glad to have you, brother.